Hi, this is Robbie from Southern California, and let's talk hummingbirds and how we went from one to thousands, and you can too. So as the days get longer and warmer, hummingbirds are now traveling all over the United States. They're leaving here. We've had thousands, and they're starting to go up north and spread across other areas where there's lots of flowers and things for them to eat. Remember, they just don't eat the sugar water we put out. They are also eating lots of pollen and insects, and they love those tiny little fruit flies. Now, let's talk about formula real quick, and then we'll get into the feeders. The formula is very easy. It's a quarter of a cup of granulated white table sugar, regular sugar, and 1 cup of water. Let me just explain that what you're feeding them, the white sugar, is sucrose. It's made up of glucose and fructose. It is a product that is naturally produced by plants, which is in your table sugar. So it is coming from plants. Sucrose is extracted from the sugar cane or sugar beet. It's refined, it's washed when it's in the raw form, it's turned into crystals, and then they're dissolved to make a sugar syrup. They're then filtered and they're passed over carbon to remove any color. What they end up with is a crystallized product that is pure sucrose, which is clear, odorless, and sweet. So what you're actually giving them is exactly what they're finding in flowers, the nectar. We're not giving them anything foreign. It's just that we can't eat a lot of it, so we have it in desserts and different foods. Let's say a third of their diet is sucrose, and that's what they need, and that's why they can beat those wings so fast and travel the way they do, and their heart pumps so much faster than many other animals. So keep that in mind. Sucrose for them is exactly what they need, and it is all made off of plants. The melting point for sugar is about 186 degrees. That's why I start with boiling water and I melt it down. So what you're doing is you've got a powder form, crystal form, which is the finished molecule of the table sugar, but it has the water completely removed out of it. And all we're doing is putting it back in. So that's why you take a quarter of a cup of sugar and 1 cup of water. The sugar becomes part of the water. So if you take it and mix it that way, you will see that it doesn't overflow a cup. The sugar goes back into the water and turns back into its natural syrup. Okay, now we've gone over that. As far as putting on hummingbird feeders, it would be really good to make the formula, and if you don't have that many hummingbirds, make one batch, which would be the quarter of a cup of granulated sugar and 1 cup of water, and then put a small amount after it's all mixed and dissolved. I have many videos showing exactly how I made it, so you'll see how I made it. It's not that difficult. It's just that I have to make up a half a gallon at a time because of all my hummingbirds. But you make that up and you have it well dissolved. You put a small amount inside your well-cleaned feeder. And you don't have to fill it, because if they're not coming there and they haven't found it yet, you want to make sure during the warm days that you go and change it every 3 or 4 days. If you see any spots of mold growing inside, definitely take it down sooner, wash it really well, and then put fresh formula back in and put it back out there. Skip the dyes when you're making the formula. It's really not important. They don't need it, and you really don't know what it's going to do to them. Dye food coloring is not part of their natural diet, so I never use food coloring. Your feeders could be either glass or plastic. That is up to you, whatever you so desire. I personally prefer plastic. It's lighter, and if you drop it, you're usually not going to break it. You drop a glass one, falls off a tree, something happens, something knocks it over, and that's kind of the end of it. The main thing you want to do is go into the store, look around and see all the different hummingbird feeders and pick out what you really like. But keep in mind, if they have a lot of nooks and crannies in there and crevices and they look beautiful, but there's a lot of little spots in there that from the flowers and designs, those designs in there, whether it's on the inside of the feeder or the outside, and when I say the outside, around the flower parts where they're feeding from, can and easily do grow mold. So you're going to have to keep an eye on that, take them off, and wash it in whatever fashion you want to. Wash it as if it was your child's dish and you need to scrub it, make sure it's clean. You will have to keep an eye on that. I tend to go for something that's very simple. Usually it's 3 pieces, top, and then the bottom part is two pieces. So I can take it apart. I can wash it really good in the sink. I can use a mascara brush to get it in and out of those holes, and then I can quickly put it all back together and get it out. If you want to go into something fancier, you want to make sure that the flowers that are on there, if it's got the bee guard flowers, that you can pop them out. If you can't pop them out, you're going to have a big problem trying to wash it. Now, the more you pop those out to wash it all the time, because you will see when you pop them out, there'll be some black mold on the inside. You'll notice that they do kind of wear out, and over time you'll try to push them back in, and the plastic sometimes, you know, kind of gives, and they can fall out, so you can lose them. If you have a bee problem and the bee guards disappear, your bees will find their way into those large holes. You can always cover those holes up with a little bit of duct tape and just use the other ones that still have your flowers on them. If you have an ant problem, you'll need an ant moat. Some of the hummingbird feeders do have ant moats built in. Now, I'm going to have a lot on ant moats coming up, including the ant moats that I've made, because some of the ones that are built in are so shallow that in the summer it can dry out quite quickly. So you can make your own ant moat or buy a separate one so there's more water in there, so it will at least last for the whole day, because the moment it dries out, those ants will find it if you've got an ant problem, and they will get to your feeder. Ants have an odd taste. If you've ever accidentally got one on you and got it in your mouth, they taste really bitter, and they will discourage the hummingbirds from coming back once they get into it. So the hummingbirds tend to leave the feeders alone once the ants find it. That's why it's good to have an ant moat if you've got an ant problem. Ants are not always a problem. Many times they don't bother it. I haven't had my feeders really bothered that much this year at all. Now, I also make sure that when I do fill my ant moats, I use fresh water in there, because occasionally I have seen them drinking from it. I know some of you have said they fill them with vinegar, oil, turpentine. I don't know, but I would only use fresh water, because as you can see here, they do on nice hot days want just a plain drink of water sometimes. There's a lot of different feeders you can make. It doesn't have to be the conventional hanging ones. You can make your own. I make dots, little ramekins, and I make them out of old ice cream containers, cottage cheese yogurt containers, all kinds of food containers, coffee containers. You can make them out of anything, really. And once they find out what it is, it only takes one to do it, then everybody else copies and ends up in there. So you can do homemade DIY feeders. That works well too. If you don't have hummingbirds around and you're trying to bring them in, it's usually good to get a cheaper type feeder, you know, something that even from the dollar store, and put it out. Something that is red, the feeder itself, not the formula, don't worry about that, and something they're going to recognize. Because as they're flying by, and you don't even know sometimes you've got hummingbirds all over the place, but as they're flying by, they will recognize it, because they are going around and feeding out of feeders all over, miles and miles around. They travel far, they're very fast, and so as they speed by, they look down, they see it, they will come in. Once they come in and know you've got feeders out, you can then tuck them around in trees and put them in the shade and put them in different areas, because they'll go hunting for them because they know there's feeders in that area. If the holes are big enough and you've got orioles around, they're going to come feed too. I generally keep the holes on my feeders bigger. I buy the ones with bigger holes because I like the orioles coming in. And it doesn't matter. They don't really bother the hummingbirds. They don't attack hummingbirds. But the hummingbirds usually will get out of the orioles' way simply because of size. And once they're done feeding, they come right back in and feed. But if you start to have a bee problem, then you may have to switch over to a feeder temporarily that has bee guards on it, which would make the hole smaller. And this way the bees cannot reach it. If they can't reach the nectar, they're going to leave because they don't have time to sit there all day trying to figure out what to do. So they generally go on their way. If it swings a lot, your feeder, and you've got nectar that is dripping out, that's usually what attracts the bees, because they find out that there's something sweet there. And then sometimes they're really determined to try to get in there. So keep your feeder in a place where it's not swinging too much, and you should be okay. So I think we've covered pretty much everything on what you'll need to know just to start bringing them in. Keep in mind, you may only have one or think you have one, but a lot of times a hummingbird comes by, it feeds, and it doesn't come back for another 15, 20 minutes because it's off in the gardens, off in the plants, looking for fruit flies, looking for flowers, because not only do they get the nectar, which is sucrose, inside the flowers, but they're also eating pollen. And you'll find them sometimes going around your house, picking off things off your house. You're wondering, what are they doing? They're picking off little tiny gnats, little tiny insects to eat, and that's what they eat too. That's where they get their vitamins from. That's where they get their protein from. They're getting that from the insects they eat. And they have to eat that. So don't think you're feeding them and they're not eating it. They know best, and they know that they need to go hunting and also have your feeder. Your feeder is a way to help out the hummingbirds. There's not as many flowers as there used to be in some areas. A lot of people have gone ahead and put a lot of cement down. There's a lot of buildings and different things around and parking lots. So where there would be weeds and wildflowers growing, which they would pick from the wildflowers, they now have to really look around to find the flowers, to find the nectar. And by you putting out feeders, you're helping them because they burn a lot of energy. And let me tell you something, if they don't get enough food by the end of the day, a lot of times they perish and they will not make it through the night. So what we're doing is helping them out. And it's very comforting to them to know that there are feeders around, so when they can't find enough, they know exactly where to come back and exactly where to get their food that they need to survive and to feed their babies. Quick note, the hummingbirds that are building their nests and sitting on eggs and producing babies and feeding them all, the little girls are doing it all on their own. The male has nothing to do with the babies. He will never know they're his babies. He breeds with the female and off he goes looking for another female. And that is it. She does everything. She's super mom. She builds her nest from scratch using spider webs. She will find the safest area that she can find, be it a bananas tree, which they nested in our bananas that time, our windowsill. She nested for 2 years on our window hook in my kitchen window, 3 feet from my face. We've got them on our deck right now. We've got them on our garage. We've got them on our front porch. We've got them in the trees. We've got nests everywhere. And they usually build them in an area so if it rains, the leaves or the eaves will keep the rain off their babies. And there she will sit for about 2 weeks till those eggs hatch. She will feed those babies in that nest for about 2 weeks, sometimes a little more until they leave. And guess what? Once she's done with that, has her babies perched in a tree, she goes back to nest again, and she could do 4 nests in a year. Each nest usually contains 2 eggs. Not always will both babies hatch. Usually they will, but if they don't, she'll raise the one baby and go through the process again until the weather starts to change and it's time for her to be done for the year. And yes, she does it all. So that's why they're very grateful, because they bring their babies to the feeders, they show their babies the feeders, and mom teaches them that this is the way to get started, and then takes them into the garden and teaches them what else they need to eat. So I hope I've given you some fun facts on hummingbirds and how we can help them out. And well, be careful what you wish for, because like I've always said, we started with one and we literally have thousands of hummingbirds now. So with that, have a wonderful, wonderful day. And don't forget to eat what you grow. Bye-bye, everybody.